Hi, welcome to the Exchange Server 2010 training videos from TimeNet Learning. My name is Subish and I will be your trainer throughout this session. In this session, we will have a look at the basic architecture of an Exchange Server 2010 environment, and we will go on and deploy an Exchange Server 2010, and then we will configure a couple of users there so that they can send emails to each other. We can start our session by having a look at the Exchange Server roles. When the Exchange Server 2007 was released, the most important difference from the previous version, that is the Exchange Server 2003, was a role-based deployment. And in Exchange Server 2007 had 5 different roles that could be installed in separate servers, and each of them will be handling a specific area of operations. The first of them is the mailbox role, and this one was responsible for saving all our emails, and it was also considered as the most important role because all our mails and databases will be saved on this server. Next, we have the transport role, where all the email going in and out of the email Exchange Server will be processed. Hub transport roles control the email transportation using the transport rules and routing policies in it. So this one is the role which decides which email goes to which server. The client access server role is nothing but where the clients access to access their emails. The most commonly used client access softwares were the Outlook web app or OWA, the MS Outlook, and the Exchange Active Synchronization for mobile users. The unified messaging server role helps us to integrate our Exchange Server organization to an existing unified messaging environment like a Cisco VoIP environment or a Microsoft Office communication environment. And the last one is the edge transport role, which can be used as an extra protection for all the other roles by standing as a standalone server outside our domain environment as a standalone machine receiving all the emails including spams and viruses, and this server will be enabled with antivirus and anti-spam, and thus it will filter all the junks and viruses and will allow only safe mails into our hub transport server. And now we will have a look at an Exchange 2010 typical architecture with all these servers installed. Here in this diagram, you can see all the 5 roles acting their own parts to set up a complete Exchange 2010 environment. You can see that all the users from inside and outside the network is connected to the client access server. The phone system is connected to the Exchange using the unified messaging role. The mailbox role has been connected to its storage space, and the hub transport server carrying its transport policies, and the edge transport server standing outside the environment protecting our environment from viruses and spam. So this is a typical architecture of an Exchange 2010 environment. And now we could move on to the prerequisites of Exchange 2010 deployment. Here we have the recommended hardware requisites. The first one will be the memory, and it is recommended to have a minimum of 4 GB of RAM and an additional 5 MB for each mailboxes that you are configuring it. And you need to have at least 1.2 GB of drive in which you are going to install Exchange 2010, and an additional 500 MB of available disk space for each unified messaging language pack that you are planning to install in Exchange 2010 for unified communications, and 200 MB of available disk space on this system drive, that is the C drive, or wherever your operating system is installed. And you need to have a DVD-ROM drive, The file format must be in TFS and a normal monitor with 800 into 600 pixels for higher resolution. Now we can go on to the software prerequisites. You need to have Microsoft .NET Framework 3.5 SP1 and Windows PowerShell version 2 to getting started. So my Exchange Server will not allow you to install it without having these two components. You can install Exchange Server 2010 on a Windows Server 2008 64-bit standard or enterprise software operating system, and you have to choose enterprise if you need to enable clustering for mailboxes or hard transport, or you can use Windows Server 2008 R2, which comes only in 64-bit, and you can again use a standard or enterprise version according to your clustering needs. We can now move on to the implementation part. Let me connect to my remote computer in which we will be installing the Exchange 2010. I am assuming that you will be having an active domain environment already, because the server needs to be a member of the domain. I won't be showing you how to install a domain in this video, but you will get it in another series. I am going to use a Windows Server 2008 R2 box to install the Exchange server now. So see you there.